Hey, I am honored to be here, and I am thrilled to be sharing the stage with Brian Sheth. He is an entrepreneur, investor, and philanthropist. Since co-founding Vista Corp in 2000, him and his partner, Robert Smith, they built Vista into one of the most largest and most successful technology investment firms globally, with over $58 billion under management. I must admit, I did not know a lot about you or your company, Brian, until AFWERX provided me this incredible opportunity. I'm not easily impressed, but every single aspect of your organization, your personal journey and your story is not only awesome, but it's inspiring. I was impressed with the professional and personal culture that I sensed from the research that I was able to do and during the little time we spent together. I know that your time is valuable, and I want to thank you for sharing it with us today. To all those on the other end, this would be a lot better if we were together, but the world has changed and we can't be. It's going to be a special treat. AFWERX, thanks for setting this up. John, thanks for allowing me to participate. Brian, great to see you again. John, we were able to talk a little bit yesterday. And one thing that stood out was your affinity for those who serve, not just in the military, but our law enforcement, our firefighters, paramedics, doctors, nurses, and many others. Online today, there are many business leaders, senior government military leaders, and most importantly, and hopefully, young junior military personnel. Is there anything you'd like to say or any advice you'd like to give those that are listening with us today?
Well, General, thanks so much for having me here. It's a real honor, and I'm excited to be a part of AFWERX and hopefully going forward part of the AFWERX community. There, as you got to know me a little bit yesterday, there's a whole lot I want to say. But first and foremost, I have to give a shout out to my family friend, Airman First Class Cameron Beagler. So thanks for letting me do that. On behalf of all the civilian partners on the phone as well and on this call, I want to just convey to all the airmen just how much we appreciate being your partner and how much we understand and recognize that the stakes are a little bit higher in terms of what you guys do than what we're typically used to in our other partners and the other avenues of our civilian lives. And it makes us extraordinarily proud to be your partner and to help, at least in our little way, further the mission that is so important of what you guys are doing. My admin and my right-hand person is actually sitting in the room with me. Her dad is a lifelong airman and navigator and flew for 20 years. And so it's just a real honor to be here today. What I'd love to say to all of you who are airmen is, you know, you are part of a very special tradition. And right now there's a lot of questioning that our country is going through about what our institutions stand for, who we are as a people, what we represent both internally and to the world. And I can tell you that the Air Force is one of the last bastions that everybody stands up and is proud of. We're familiar with your great work, but more importantly, we are so proud of the way in which you do it. And that's why it's just so great for all of you, especially you young folks, younger than the general and myself, to be starting your career in such an extraordinary institution. And I'm sure we're going to talk a little bit about some of the ways we've tried to model aspects of Vista after what you guys do, but it's really extraordinary. And congratulations to all of you.
Thanks, Brian. That is just, it warms my heart to know that you appreciate, you know, those of us who choose to serve in this capacity. You've been extremely successful and have found ways to put together teams of extremely resilient partners and employees. One of the most powerful quotes that I found on your site was, "We have the power to persevere." And as I research your business, it seems that you focus on building a resilient team of businesses and putting together parts of a puzzle. The team brings together the strengths of each and creates an overall organization that is stronger than the sum of the individual parts. And you do it in a dignified and respectful manner. I know that you're going to say it's luck, but I'm not going to let you get off the hook that easily. What drove you to adopt this method? And how has it made Vista more resilient and stronger by the relationships that you've built with these other partners?
Yeah, thanks so much. And it's kind of the question, isn't it? Because it really goes to the core of leadership and culture. We were lucky and fortunate, my partner and I, that a very early mentor was part of, you know, sadly, another of the armed services. I won't mention them on air, but someone referred to him recently as the misguided children. But he was tremendously proud of the testing and training that they did there. And he impressed upon us how important it was not only to make sure that you take care of the people that you have, but give the people that you have a sense that they all belong there and that, you know, it wasn't so easy to get there. And so we started with this approach that folks in the military are very familiar of testing all of the folks who wanted the opportunity to work both at Vista and our companies. And it's not an easy test, just like many of the tests that the airmen have to go through to advance and succeed in the Air Force. And so there's tremendous pride, as they should have, in folks who are part of the Vista family. And then, frankly, we reward, you know, that hard work to pass that with a tremendous amount of training. And as you and I discussed, you know, there's nothing more important than training the great people that you have. One of the great sins that any organization, whether civilian or military, can do is take tremendously talented people, especially young people, and not train them appropriately before they send them on mission.
Yeah.
In our business, we call that bruising the fruit. In your business, the stakes are a lot higher and the consequences are a lot more dire. But, you know, I think the similar perspective is the same, which is if your people are the most important aspect of who you are and what you are, you have to invest in their training. And that training has to change over time, because the success that you had yesterday oftentimes doesn't bear a whole lot of resemblance to the success that you're going to need tomorrow. And, you know, you and I talked yesterday about how important it is to be lucky, but you got to survive to the point where you can take advantage of the luck that you're given. So that's probably the core of what makes some of our companies so resilient. And then on the flip side, it really comes down to leadership and the culture that our leaders instill across our organizations. And, you know, if you don't mind, I'd like to tell one story. It means a tremendous amount to me, having seen them again. One of our CEOs, I apologize, a different arm. he went to Annapolis and sailed around on submarines.
We'll forgive him. We'll forgive him.
But other than that, he was a great guy.
Yeah. Okay.
And then he started a business that some of you might be familiar with called MindBody, which is the largest software company for wellness and spas and fitness organizations. And if you think about it, you probably haven't up till this point, but if you think about an industry that has gotten crushed by COVID, it's really that gym, wellness, and spa industry. You know, these are the last businesses that have been allowed to reopen. And most of these businesses are started by small business people and entrepreneurs. So these are passionate folks. These are people who are deeply embedded in their communities, and their doors have been shuttered for months and months. And so software companies, you know, by the very nature of what we do and how we do it, are pretty resilient. We have a great business model, but it's pretty tough when your customers can't pay you for 6 months, which is what we're coming on to. And Rick Stolmeyer, the CEO, has just been stalwart in the way that he's managed the organization. Voluntarily cutting his salary, then by setting that example, convincing his team that they should also make these voluntary cuts, and which didn't make it any easier when they had to turn around and look at their organization and say, we're not going to survive if we don't make cuts. But they were able to do so. And even though this was a business that has been growing every year for almost 20 years since he started it, and they had no history of making cuts or anything like that, the company pulled together, recognizing that their customers were hurting more than they were. And they put in twice as many hours to build new products that they thought that their customers were going to appreciate, things like online and video training for many of the trainers who weren't getting any income, and video access to some of the content that the larger gym memberships historically charged for. And they did all that without being asked. It was incredible. You know, they stepped up and they did it. And then in May, the tremendously emotional George Floyd death happened, and the impact to Minnesota and then ultimately the rest of the country. And the African-American community in particular is a big and important part of the MindBody community. So after this company had been knocked down and knocked back, they lost almost 30% of their employee base. They'd been working overtime, building new products. Rather than letting this be the last thing to knock him over and not get up, instead they decided, and again, a management team that had cut their salaries for the year, they decided that they would voluntarily, without Vista's asking, put together a series of funds to build wellness programs in inner cities and to engage even more in the communities that they felt were most affected by what was going on and where they saw the least amount of justice and fairness. And it was just extraordinary. And they inspired us at Vista to get involved with that. But it was truly the leadership of Rick and his team. And, you know, I don't know what else 2020 can throw at him at this point, insofar as a business, but it's been extraordinary to watch them, you know, run their business and have some of the best products that they've ever come out with all these things that have been in front of them. And then most importantly, you know, show the country that, you know, they have empathy, and despite what's going on with their company, they're going to be a part of the solution going forward with the other things that are impacting our nation. So that to me is a resilient business. And I'm just really excited that the training and the culture and all the investments that Rick and his team has made over the years really played out. Because we really don't know until times of crisis, right, General?
Right. You can't. It's not something you can measure until you face it. Hey, we should probably get back to why this event's actually happening, building the base of the future. So I'm going to, as you know, Tyndall, the surrounding communities were devastated by a Category 5 hurricane. And we are now rebuilding from the ground up, basically. Unlike other bases, we now have the opportunity to design and build a base of the future to focus on many areas that our previous speakers had talked about. So what lessons did you learn in, when you're building Vista that you could take away to help make the community and the base more resilient, survivable, connected, and linked and synced in this digital world?
Yeah, you know, I'd love to speak about two things. They're kind of at the opposite ends of the spectrum, but you know, first and foremost, just recognizing that the loss of the base to the hurricane was a traumatic event. And for all of your airmen, you know, you guys are in a very tough business and you're all extremely tough. But many of you, probably most of you, have families as well. And your families are your silent partners in all of this. And your kids still need to look at you as, you know, the mom and dads, the heroes that they see, and the tremendous stress that you've been going through when you lose that base, it affects your families too, even in ways that you probably don't see it. And so I think, you know, the first thing I would say is just be cognizant of that. Unfortunately, you guys have to be heroes every day at work, but then you got to be home and recognize that in the eyes of your kids, you're still heroes. And you got to wear that. And one of the ways I would say that is involve them. Sometimes tough people like yourselves think that the best way to deal with adversity is to suck it up and to be stoic. But, you know, in my own experience, and this is less business and more being married for almost 20 years, sometimes when you share what's going on with you and you share the pain that you have at work, especially something as traumatic as what happened to you guys with the base, that opens up the opportunity for them to heal as well, because they're going through the same thing. They don't get to see it every day because they're not part of the rebuilding process, but they're with you every day and they're your biggest cheerleaders, their biggest fans. And as I said, you guys are the heroes for your kids. And so, you know, sharing that doesn't make you weak. It actually makes you more approachable. It makes you, you know, even cooler and stronger in the eyes of your family. So I would just encourage you guys to maybe remember that. In terms of building the base itself, you know, General and I talked about this the other day. You know, in our business, it's the threats you don't anticipate. And so it really comes down to building agile organizations and building that base so that you guys can flip and be nimble when those threats come that maybe you didn't anticipate. I was telling the General a story yesterday about a cybersecurity attack. We like you, spend a tremendous amount of time, effort, energy, and money on cybersecurity. It's growing to maybe the top of the list in terms of the things that are important in Vista businesses, because every aspect of what we do is digital. And the information that we have for both our companies and our customers is critical to what we do every day. Again, the stakes aren't as high with what you guys are dealing with, but for our business, it's mission critical. And we got hacked recently, one of our companies, with the lowest end hack. Nobody even thought about it. Frankly, because it was so low end and nobody thought about it, it was very effective. It cost the company $18,000, and this was a pretty big business. So the dollar costs were low, and we were very, very lucky. Going back to what the general said, let's be fortunate that we can last long enough to be lucky when the luck comes. But it made us realize that we were anticipating, and we were training, and we were scheduling all of our deployments around these very sophisticated threats. And it didn't mean that these low-end actors were still going to go after us. And so I would give you that example to just say some of the threats that you guys are going to deal with, you're not even thinking about. And the impact of what's going on, I don't think 18 months ago, many of us were thinking about a global pandemic and the impact it was going to have on every aspect of our lives, not just our work and our families, but the supply chains, the communities in which we interact, you know, the culture that we were going to be involved with, the way it was going to affect the collaboration and innovation for all the projects all of us collectively are working on. And we have to be resilient, nimble, and be agile enough in the way in which we create things to be able to deal with those things. So that's the thing. And I know we talked about this yesterday, you know, a base for you guys, 100 years ago, it was a physical thing. And now you guys have probably more digital infrastructure than any of our companies, which is extraordinary. But that's what I would say from a cultural standpoint, I'd encourage you guys to think about.
Hey, real quick, a couple quick ones, and then they're going to give us the hook. You know, Dr. Roper said something earlier today that I think is very insightful. He said that you can't win with the military alone. And so, you know, I think that as technology evolves and the pace and the agility, as you mentioned, with some of the tops they talked about, DevSecOps, Agile, you know, getting things out to market faster. You know, what have you seen in your interactions with governments, you know, and with Department of Defense, and the willingness to be able to do at the speed that it takes in your business capacity versus in the military capacity? And then how can we make that easier for industries to be, you know, who are leading the technological innovation delivery capabilities? How do we break those walls or barriers down so that we can do it better together?
Yeah, well, the first thing I'd say is, you know, I've been in the software business for over 20 years, and working with DoD and selling software into the various armed services for almost that entire period of time. And let me tell you, it's getting better every year. So let me start with that. You know, one of the things that I think made it difficult in the early days is, you know, the security and control in the digital world is different than in the physical world. And ironically, transparency is one of the most important things in the digital world. And the more that standards rules in software and the digital realm are transparent, it actually makes things safer. You know, that was a hard thing to explain to some folks who are in the business of keeping people safe and keeping secrets. And so I think that's been a journey, but I think that's something that today's DoD has really embraced and understands. You know, AppWorks is an example of how you guys have innovated your way around it.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
Sometimes smaller is better. And you know, when we started Vista 20 years ago, my partner and I, you know, we would look at these big firms and we'd be, you know, we'd make all sorts of statements around how big and, you know, how slow they were, et cetera. And now, of course, 20 years later, I think we've become what we beheld a little bit. But, you know, one of the things that we recognized fairly early on was we should always have a small arm. So if you look at Vista and all of our funds, many of them have gotten bigger and bigger and bigger. And along that time, we would take some of our top people and redeploy them towards some of the smallest companies. Why? Because small individual units oftentimes come up with the most innovative ideas out of necessity because they don't have the resources.
Yeah.
And, you know, it might be counterintuitive. You might say, you know, what are you talking about? Google has access to all the best PhDs on the planet. You guys know
survival. That.
Yeah, exactly right. You know, when your back is to the wall and you've only got a few people on whom you can count, you come up with some really innovative solutions. And in the software world, those solutions can scale. So that's why I was so impressed as I was reading about AppWorks and reading about the commitment to it. You know, it's exactly the right type of program to make sure that with all the amazing people that you have, all the tools, all of the money that you have at your disposal, you still have access to new thinking, new ideas from small folks, from small businesses, and from innovative teams. I think that's one of the big things that is the biggest change I've noticed over the 20 years that I've been doing this and working with your team members, you know, and working with folks in the Pentagon. You know, as I told you yesterday, I had the good fortune of being on a board with a bunch of the folks from Raytheon, and they, most of them were retired military and then had gone on to work at Raytheon, tremendously committed to the mission. But it was a little bit of a culture challenge in terms of our $300 million company that we pushed into their giant business and, you know, getting a rocket exactly in, you know, 1 meter square thing about 3,000 miles away is a little bit of a different challenge than writing code for cybersecurity. And so I think just the recognition that sometimes those cultural things are different and different is okay is critical. And they got that. And that's why it's been such a successful venture for the two of us.
Hey, that's awesome, Master. Thanks. Now we're about to run out of time here, but I just, you know, I wanted to see if you're willing to share with you, told me yesterday when I talk about balance, right? I got my sign right back here where it talks, you know, but you shared a story with me about balance. Many of us struggle, as you do, with, you know, many of your different hats as an entrepreneur, philanthropist, husband, father, and just a great guy. But I was wondering if you could share a little story you told me last night, because I think it'll help us all to realize what's important. And as we go through these journeys in life, that, you know, it's not what we see, it's what others see. And so if you would just talk about balance a little bit, and then I think they're going to cut us off.
Yeah, so I told the general, I actually read him the letter that my daughter, who just turned 9, wrote me. And it was the first week of May. And like you guys, we've been scrambling for months dealing with COVID and the impact. And, you know, we all like to think we're great dads because our great parents, because, you know, we love our kids so much and they're always at the forefront of our minds. But like all things in terms of priorities, sometimes we don't realize how we're spending our time. So my daughter left a note for me on the kitchen table in the morning, knowing that I was going to come down for my mid-morning coffee. And it said, "Dad, I love you very much. You're spending too much time on the phone. 70% on calls, only 5% with me and Devin, my son. Here's what I want: 40% on calls and 50% with me and Devin. If you could do that, it would be great." And then she said, "Dad, you're important to me." And, you know, gave me great perspective. I thought I was doing important stuff, trying to work with our companies at the time, thinking that we had to do all this stuff to save them. And it made me realize in a very real way that I wasn't in the moment prioritizing right. And it made me thoughtful around all the folks with whom I was working at our companies, because they were dealing with the same thing. Their kids were watching them work. And at the end of the day, as General and I talked about, all of us just want to be heroes in the eyes of our kids. And as long as we recognize that humanity in each other, I think we can go a long way collectively.
Well, hey, Brian, we've come to the end of our time. First of all, let me say thank you for taking time out of, I know, your crazy schedule. You know, that could have been an extra 2% there to be with your daughter. but thanks for sharing your insights on business, on the great value of what we do in our military, and the relationships, and how we can make not only bases more resilient, but how we can make our own institutions more resilient. And your insights were spot on, and thank you for your time. And I miss seeing you with the Boston Red Sox hat on, because I know that I know you'd rather have that hat on than have your hair look as nice as it does right now. Thanks for your time, my friend.
General, thanks so much. Appreciate it. And thank you to all of you airmen who are out there. You can't imagine, you guys are doing it every day, so you don't think about it, because that's not why you do it, but you've got an entire nation behind you, and we couldn't appreciate you more than we do. God bless all of you guys.
Thanks, Brian. Good luck. God bless you too.
Thank you.